Ticket design was started by Nishma. She started it while we were in Goa. I was employed. I was working with a company called Film Corporation, which is just into cameras and photographic equipment and stuff like that. And Nishma was that time working with Tata Johnson Controls, a Tata Group company, where she was going to talk about. She designed the Indica seats.
Yeah.
There.
So after I, and that was in Pune. I was here for some time. Then I quit and joined him in Goa. And then I started freelancing in Goa. And while I was freelancing, I actually experienced that I was doing only one type of product. And I wanted diversity, I wanted a good variety. So I thought that it was a good opportunity to do something and have you know, a lot of different types of things to do. So I started freelancing, and those days freelancing was not easy because people didn't know what was product design. They didn't know what was industrial design, and the industry in Goa is very scattered. There are many industrial areas, but they are like very far apart. So it was not very easy to contact them, travel all the distance and meet them. But I did that. Like, I used to contact them, travel the distance, meet them.
This was early 90s.
Late
90s.
98, 99. Okay. Yeah. So I used to, you know, explain to them what product design is, how it can benefit them.
We had to explain it to the banker also because we didn't have any money.
Yeah,
so,
yeah. So
we had to take a loan to buy the first computer and the first mobile phone.
Yeah, it's those days mobile phones had just come in, you know, and that was the only communication link that was available. So it was, I had to write a long note on why I want to do this. Of course, they did agree to it, and they realized that yes, it was quite a genuine request. So it started with that, you know. And
I remember we took a loan of 55,000 rupees.
Yeah, it started.
Out of which 40,000 was for the computer and 15,000 was for mobile phone. Big Motorola mobile phone.
Yeah, it was like a pencil box, big one. And it started with that, and then I started doing projects in Goa. And very soon I realized that although there is industry, but the kind of resources required for design were not sufficient. There was not the ecosystem.
Place.
Ecosystem was not you know, not conducive to industrial design or product design, especially when you're trying to freelance and you need a lot of support, like in terms of model making and rapid prototyping and testing and trials and all kinds of things. So, if we, you know, during those days in the beginning, I did have a few people who were doing these things for me, and it did started working out. Like, you would have to train them also. It was the first time they were doing these things, and then somehow I felt that because I had worked in Pune, I felt that, you know, Pune is a much better place in terms of working. So we wanted to be here, so we decided to move here, and we moved here.
No, we started manufacturing products in Goa.
Yeah.
Since there was
a period when I was only talking to people and trying to explain to them
about design,
and I didn't really have projects in hand. So at that time, I started doing my own designs, and we started manufacturing things.
Basically, Goa is a tourist destination, so people don't come to Goa to work.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
So we were there trying to, you know, get work done. What we did, she designed the products, and then we got it manufactured locally. They are lifestyle products under the brand name called Ellie Products, and we used to sell these products to stores all over Goa.
There were home stores, you know, lifestyle stores. We were selling it to them, and they were retailing it.
So it went on for a while, I think a couple of years.
Yeah.
Before people started copying it.
Yeah.
And
right.
Everybody, the entire market was flooded with copies, and
yeah.
We didn't know how to handle that.
And besides, by that time I had quite a few projects which were product design projects, and my main interest was that. So,
that was the first royalty agreement we had, by the way, where the products were designed and somebody else was manufacturing it, and it was paying royalty on each sale. So it was quite an experience.
After all of that, we moved to Pune, and when we moved to Pune, I still had some projects going on there. So I used to like virtually travel every 15 days to take care of things till they were concluded well.
And when did you move to Pune?
In 2000.
We set up the ticket design in its current form in 2000.
Yeah.
And since then, it has been, we've been working on it.
Yeah, in Pune then he also
In 2000 when we moved to Pune, I quit the company that I was working in, because
while this was going on, you continued to work.
I was working, I was employed, because you know, you have to have the kitchen work. Otherwise it was very difficult, because one person has to take the decision, and we were just out of college that time, just one, two, so we, after 3 years of working, we decided to set up this. So we moved to Pune.
Yeah.
And that time...
And the hands were quite full at that time. Like, my hands were quite full. I was unable to handle it alone. I needed, people to be working. There were a couple of engineers who came on board. And then it was not possible even design to be managed. Then he came on board, and then we just took off as ticket design. We formally named it Ticket Design. And
what were the kind of projects that you got during that time? And you said you had quite a few projects.
I will tell you what we worked on, very interesting projects. There was one shelter that we had done for defense. It was a completely dismantleable fiberglass shelter, and they could be heliported. This was done in Goa. And it was made of symmetrical panels, like domed shelters. And every panel was calculated to be less than 20 kgs, because the defense personnel cannot carry more than 20 kgs on their back on a slope. So these shelters were to be put up in places like Kargil, extreme climates where it's very cold.
It was actually deployed there.
Yeah, it was deployed there. Yeah.
That was our first brush with the government, because what we realized is that this became very popular.
It was all tender-based thing.
The shelters became very popular, and then defense set that as the specification.
Yeah, they changed.
So we had to literally, our design was taken away.
Yeah, yes. Not just from us, even from the manufacturer, because that's the only way they could get into the business. Yeah, and the defense wants to control.
So that was
a
very
big
good
success.
It was, we felt very good about it.
Yeah.
We felt very good about it. In fact, there was another project that she worked on during that time, was with Siemens. She designed an X-ray machine for them, which was again a transformation. I think that was the biggest opportunity that we used to look for, that what is the potential for transformation in any other project that comes in. And you see that transformation happening, and that's the joy.
We did a tractor cave-in also for Mahindra, that's for the tractors. Then water heaters, and what else did you do? Then when we came here, we started, we worked on this multi-parameter monitor.
That was our first client in the incorporated company, where we went and that was the first concept selling that we did, and we went
air conditioners,
met these customers.
Monitors. This, I think, this multi-parameter monitor, later on we did the version 1, and then we did the version 2 of the product. And
that was an interesting experience, because it was a small and medium scale, very small company, but doing very good work. Nasan, name of the company.
Local, it's a Pune company.
Pune based company. Yeah. So, they were giving tough competition to the established players in the market, but they were still being looked at as a very, the products were not being professional in their, in the packaging, the way user, not very user friendly.
They used to take very long to assemble them.
Assemble the
so
product.
You know, they would have orders, but they won't be able to meet it. So like each product used to take 8 hours to assemble, and it would take them that much time to supply. Which means the cash also rolls in that much delayed. So
we worked on that product. This is that multi-parameter product there. It's basically a medical device, again, used for checking ECG and various other parameters.
It's in the ICUs, yeah.
So we were concept selling the services to them, like what is design, how you can... It was very difficult for them to invest in design because they felt it was probably more expensive, too expensive. But then as
design
we started working
and,
on it...
Design and manufacturing.
Design and manufacturing. Yeah.
Because tools and, you know, large-scale manufacturing requires a certain amount of investment.
Yeah, but at the end of the day, design is a risk, you know, because you are taking the first step.
It's new and it's
a risk that anybody takes, but it's an investment as well. So, while working with them, I think there was a confidence that got built up and they really went ahead and took a bank loan to invest in the tooling because they were making it in sheet metal earlier. So, they invested in the tooling. And then the product came out.
We did the first version of the product, which reduced the time from 8 hours to 6 hours. Then that was also not enough because, you know, he used to always say that, you know, I have so many orders but I can't meet them. So we said that let's do molding for this. We do injection molding tooling. You need to invest. Then we did the injection molded product for them, which again reduced the time from 6 hours to 2 hours. So, you know, in a day, in a shift, when they used to make one person, would make one assembly, they started making, you know, many, like about 6 to 8 assemblies. And their manufacturing capability went up that much. And if you tally the figures, that their output went up that much.
No, the sales,
and their sales went up
in
that
the first year of the launch of the product, the sales improved by 1,200%.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And that was again
because
a moment
they could,
of,
you know, they could meet the orders that they had in hand. We had to educate them. I'll tell you a story of what happened once. We had gone for there was a company. It's a big firm in Pune. I don't think
it's
I should name
big,
it.
It's a big, very large company.
Very large firm in Pune. I don't think I should name it. They called us because they wanted design, so I think from somewhere they got a reference and they called us, and we went there, and they had the team in the room, and we
the
were
entire
making
R&D team was sitting R&D there. We were making a presentation.
We were making a presentation of the kind of work that we have done and what we do. So I think 20-30 minutes into the presentation, we were talking of case study.
We were showing them various products that we have designed
and the way
slide
we went
slide.
About doing it. You know? And one of the guys asked a question, saying that. Okay, so if we feed in our requirement, the material and the specifications and the kind of
how much does the software cost?
Will the software be able to give us a design? How much does the software cost? I said, well, this is not a software, you know. Then we closed down our presentation. We said, I think we need to start afresh. We are not selling a software.
The software is here.
The software is. In your mind, you know, you're going to come out with new design, and that's what we do. Then they understood that we worked with them. Surprisingly, we proposed certain ideas to them, which they really, we were not expecting them to take them up because it was questioning the basics, you know. It was about boilers and some things to do with fundamentals of how the boilers work. And we thought that, you know, sometimes you want to propose, you have this itch of proposing something very different, and you are sure that because it is so radically different, probably too early to come and might not get taken up. So maybe there will be safer and easier to implement solutions will be taken up. We were very surprised that they agreed to, you know, prototype the new idea that we gave, and they did prototype it.
But it has been a push that the design, whatever design we have worked on, if I look back, there has always been a push from our side. And you just push and just check the receptivity, I mean, the receptiveness.
Risk-taking ability.
Yeah, probably the innovation appetite of that company or that group of people. And then if it works well, then you can really push and break new boundaries and, you know, really try something else. And it has always been a complementary effort that is required from the client side or the project team side. Only then it goes far. Otherwise it remains a service.
you know, about what you asked, that, you know, whether it was small firms, MSME types, or was it big corporations where design was coming into the picture. I think it was all, both, and awareness was improving. We had to explain it to them, but they felt a need, but they didn't know what it was. They could not articulate that need very well. So we had to somewhere, you know, come halfway and then meet somewhere in between and then carry the solution forward. And the need was coming up, and we had to explain to them what is it that design can do, what is the contribution that we can make. And so what Bala was talking about, that risk appetite, sometimes there were some companies who were ready to take a higher risk, because higher innovation needs higher risk, and lower the innovation, simpler the solution, easier to implement, is lower risk. So some people were ready to take that and some people were not. We contributed in whatever, you know, best way we could, because you got to do everything, you do all types of design. So sometimes the innovation is very high, sometimes it's not. So it just went along that way.
Yeah, it needs to be a partnership.
Although it has improved a lot in the last many years that we have seen it, we have come a long way, a long, long way. But it is still there. I mean, we don't have to explain to people what is product design and industrial design anymore. They know. And when they come with the requirement, they sometimes, a lot of times, even have a brief ready, you know. They even know what they are looking for, which is wonderful for us, yeah.
So you were talking about this whole experience about how you are interacting with the client and both of you see a journey together. So the name ticket came about from this whole experience, that you know, every project that we worked on, whether it is a consumer durable or a packaging or it is a medical device, it's a totally new journey for us. For us as well as the client or any of the team members that are there. So we look at this every journey as a very adventurous journey. And ticket design is your ticket to design.
It's a pass. It's a pass to the journey.
That's the medium that you have for reaching there.
The client comes with a requirement, you know. They come with a brief. We analyze and study that brief. But it's not just about meeting that brief. It's about going beyond that brief and meeting the real needs. So sometimes those real needs are not articulated in the brief. Most of the times they're not. Because briefs are usually made from what exists and what has already been experienced. But when we talk to people, when we understand what users have to do, we realize that it needs to go beyond that. And we do make you know, proposals of things that go little beyond that. And then we warn them that, you know, this goes a little beyond the brief. So if they're ready to accept it, a lot of times when it's logically seen, you know, people do realize that yes, this can make a big difference, and they accept it. And when they accept it, we have to work a little more towards making it happen, and we go full length to make it happen, which includes doing a lot of experimentations, which includes doing a lot of trials. Sometimes you have to do a trial first and show it to the client, because sometimes words are not enough.
That's the biggest issue, actually. Yeah. Because initially, when we were working with the clients, there was always these kind of questions, typically from American clients. You know, show us your capability. How will it work? Whether it will actually... what if your designs are not okay? Right? What if we are not... So that issues, I think everybody faces that, you know, because design is a risk, and it's a development process, experimental in nature.
Especially so industrial design.
Industrial design, experimental nature, and when you...
Costs are high.
And what comes out at the end, and it's the industry is also very disorganized. There's no structured method that you will follow a process, or you have a design project and you go to three different design companies, and you'll get completely different results depending on where... what is the vision of that company. So initially that was the issue, but how do you want to convince or showcase what is going to be in the deliverable. So if right now I think that problem we don't have. So whatever we are doing, there is always a lot of confidence in what we are doing, and we are able to take bigger jumps, and there's a lot of freedom in terms of where you want to go. And at the right, like you earlier said, the smaller MSME kind of customers, as well as multinationals, across the spectrum, there have been projects coming in. And in terms of the design risk that they are able to take, they are ready to take, it varies. We feel that sometimes the smaller and medium companies are ready to take more risks than the multinational because they are very tight and then they give you a very small leg room, elbow room, sorry.
Yeah. Also the decisions are faster, decision makers are involved. Straight away, like the owner will be involved.
Yeah, we love to work with business owners because you know the CEO level kind of a partnership where we have enough confidence between each other. We can even so it's like initially it was like this. You know, this is the client and this is the designer, design company. So the client gives you a brief and you give the design back to them. So when now what has happened is that the client comes to us and we both of us look at the design, and then we say that okay, where do you want to go? And as long as the client sees what you see and you show him or her what you visualize in that potential problem, then both of us can, because both of us have to learn from each other and move forward.
And especially with industrial design, it I think has to go hand in hand, because the design doesn't stop at just what you have put together on paper and given as your design and output of your design as CAD models or drawings or whatever. It has to get manufactured like. Manufacturing is as important, and
that's
it has
what,
to the design. Design intent has to be absolutely realized well, because if in the transition, if the design intent is lost, then there is a compromise somewhere. So that to carry that design intent forward right till the end has been our attempt, and a lot of times wherever it's possible, we do our own detailing engineering and we release it for tooling. We even have you know, tie-ups with tooling people in India, in Taiwan, where we work with them. We've been working with them for years, where you know, they understand the kind of output that we require.
So we work with them early.
Yeah, we work with them early.
At the ideation level itself.
Yeah, and there is a little bit of to and fro that happens, where you know, we try and tell them that this is how we want it. And if they have a problem, they say that, you know, this is where we need to do something. Then they give us suggestions, we give them suggestions, we find a solution to the problem. And not just, you know, compromise. So the idea is to move forward.
That's one
issue
that we have faced here. There is a lot of manufacturing good base in India. And we would, there, and given a choice, we would like to do that in India first. But the problem is that everybody is busy with the big guys. And there is a temperament issue in terms of handling new development. Everybody wants an established product. You say, okay,
yeah,
I can make this in India.
It's already there. You see it, you reverse engineer and do it. And the moment it is something to be thought about from your mind, is something new that does not exist, it becomes very difficult to handle.
You need a developmental temperament to handle design. Thank you.